Radio wins the Public Radio Jazz Challenge.
And that was the kids on the drums. It may be cold outside, but in here it is hot. We're playing the most from the Irish coast. We're live from the capital. For all of you out there needing a remedy, here's Brian Kennedy with Message in the Box.
Back to another episode of Anthony Meets, and this is all centered around my part of the world, Northern Ireland. And in this section, we're going to be meeting a few people who have broken through, I suppose, the imaginary glass ceiling or barriers that we all think we have. But the chap that I'm going to talk to now, I can't really convey to you how his stardom really did just blow everybody in Northern Ireland away, and the heights that he was able to reach, and the talent that he exuded, was just boundless. So it really is a pleasure to introduce you to Brian Kennedy. Brian, how are you?
Goodness me, what an intro. Thank you very much for that.
I was trying to remember what you made me write down, Brian.
Can I just say to the people listening, he said to me, what do you want me to say? And I said, say anything you like, Mr. Miller.
Yeah, he did, honestly. Brian, you've got a gig coming up in Larne with the fabulous Mary Coughlan and, of course, Curtis Stigers. Tell us about that.
That's right. Well, I mean, it's, as you know, this year has been the 25th anniversary Good Friday Agreement. I wrote a song at the time called Life, Love and Happiness that people didn't really realize was written about it. I mean, also, it was kind of subterraneally begin, you know, the beginning of it was like I was on a break from making A Better Man, that record.
Right.
And we realized that we needed something up tempo, because I could certainly write ballads and mid-tempo things, and that seems to be my kind of default setting in terms of songwriting. But a really big up-tempo banger, Isn't the World, you know, Forget Your Troubles, Come On, You're Happy. That's kind of, you know, that's much harder for me. So I went home, and of course, what was in the ether in Northern Ireland was this idea that we could not return to where we had been before.
Yeah.
You know, so the idea of, you know, don't let go again, don't give up again, all of those kind of phrases were running around my brain. And I went back to London to work with a guy called Peter Vitesse, who just got this most amazing track together.
Yeah.
And so I started writing about, you know, thinking about myself as a younger boy, talking about, you know, will you walk with me through this world? And I basically, you know, they say sometimes, what would you tell your younger self?
Yeah.
You know, and ultimately, especially as a young queer person,
yeah,
as a young fella from Northern Ireland, even though you were talking about invisible ceilings. I mean, ours were right in front of us.
We
literally had barricades in front of us. We literally had turnstiles if you lived in our side of town. So, you know, certainly I had those physical barriers to get through just as a young Catholic person because of my postcode, never mind an identity issue. I mean, I didn't, you know, I'm certainly more than fully cooked these days at 56 and a half that I am. But certainly back in the day, you know, one thing at a time. And the first thing to really try and, you know, get out of the way was this notion that you were lesser than because of your postcode. So
yeah.
Again, fast forward to the future, my God, you know, I became this singer. How on earth did that happen? I didn't come from, you know, musician people, really. It didn't, wasn't, I mean, I have to look into my gene pool, really. But hey, I just had my Ancestry.com done.
All right.
And I'm 88% Ulster Irish. And what's the other 12%, do you think?
I'm going to go with, American.
I'm Scottish.
Oh, okay.
So I could, in other words, I couldn't be more Celtic if I tried.
No, you couldn't, Joey.
No. So it's interesting that was so really, really at the center of me because,
yeah.
You know, being an Irish person at that time in history in Northern Ireland, you know, you felt very illegal all the time. And also, I had another secret. I liked fellas, you know.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I had to really keep that one under wraps. But certainly, yeah, I mean, Life, Love and Happiness, Good Friday Agreement, all of this stuff now has come around to this concert in Larne, getting back to the, you know, answering the actual question, which is now we have opportunities to gather in communities, not just in the centre of Belfast, but places like Larne, where, like I say before, that Larne Stranraer ferry,
yeah,
it's very much like the one that went from Cove to America. That's where people went and left and lived with their families, you know, in Scotland and different places like that. So we have a long history of emigration, all of those things. And how wonderful is it that we will gather in Larne to sing, to celebrate, to say we're here. We've gotten through some of the most awful times in history. And now we can, you know, celebrate together as a community.
Yeah, and you know, and by the way, there's so much about what you said there that I want to unpack. So remind me to come back to that because your story is really it's heartbreaking in many ways, but massively inspirational
and heart mending in many ways too.
Yeah,
heartbreaking,
absolutely.
Heart mending. It really is because music is, I think, some of the greatest medicine that has ever, you know, existed on our planet, certainly.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know that, you know, I mean, this magazine is Career 40 and it's people around the world. And what we had in Northern Ireland and that unique position there, it is replicated in different ways. So I definitely want to get there with you. But just sticking with the gig for a second, it's a reunion in many ways. So it's a reunion in terms of we have the anniversary of the GFA.
Yes.
You, Mary and Curtis. That's a bit of a reunion as well.
I mean, it really is because if you forward, you know, if you look on, you know, as we know, Google is our God these days. One of them. And if you look back, you'll see obviously me singing with Van Morrison, you know, on that day, the Clinton administration, all the things that were going on to make sure that we got out. We were stuck in that awful gear. And then suddenly it was possible to go up a gear and actually move forward. So part of the soundtrack of that change was Van Morrison, myself, Mary Coughlin, Curtis Stigers, you know, all the way from America, from Boise, Idaho, you know, and Curtis and I have met briefly around then. Obviously, you know, I Wonder Why was his big hit. We were saying around the same time, 1990, we're talking about here. We both had loads of hair. I unbelievably seem to still manage to have held on to most of mine, and it's still darkish. And so we were kind of solo artists at the same time, around and about and doing things and all that. So we encountered each other a little bit over the years. We actually ended up writing a song called Don't Look at Me That Way and then recorded it together on my album, Get On With Your Short Life, in 2000 in America when I was living in New York. So we have these wonderful little moments of connection. And then how wonderful will it be to connect again all these years later in Larne? It's going to be great.
I think it's absolutely gorgeous. Is it the Friends Festival or?
Yes, exactly.
The Friends Festival, yeah.
Exactly.
And it's linked to America and whatnot as well. So yeah, absolutely gorgeous. I'm raging that I can't be there. But
okay, you can be there in a cyber capacity.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sure somebody will be filming it somewhere, of course.
Oh, well, you know, Michelle, I'll have her torture for videos and stuff.
You know, if
sorts.
Anybody can sort it, Michelle can.
Yeah, absolutely. I just wanted to go back. I was a Catholic boy growing up in Northern Ireland too. But I lived.
How old are you, by the way? That's an awful question to ask.
I'm nearly 45.
You're nearly 45. I'm nearly 57.
Yeah.
I only ask because it tells me culturally
where it was.
You were a teenager. You were 21. You were, you know, that's the only reason I ask.
Yeah. 78. I was born.
Right.
But so I lived in Antrim, which you would know would have been predominantly a Protestant town. It was a loyalist area. And it had one Catholic estate in it, one Catholic primary school, one Catholic secondary school.
Right.
So sometimes we lived in the Catholic estate, sometimes we lived in the Protestant estates. We moved about as you did back in the day.
Yeah.
But I remember, you know, I went to Catholic school, wore the Catholic uniform. So you always had that kind of, you were in an omnipresent state of fight, which it was, you know, some people have flight. We didn't have flight. It was that constant sort of flight mode or fight.
Well, the airport was too far away.
Yeah.
On every level.
Yeah, only rich people went on airplanes, for goodness.
That's correct.
But what you said there, and it really hit home with me, because I remember that, you know, that the jungle rules, having to fight and having to argue and having to, you had to prove your masculinity.
Yes.
But at this other side of your brain, you're thinking, oh, I fancy him. Mm. And then little experiences were happening and different sorts of things were going on.
Yes.
And I think when we talk about the troubles, we forget that story, don't we, of the people who lived underneath all of that other crazy stuff that was going on.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because you have, on one hand, like you had in England, the Dick Emery show, or, you know, those kind of people. We had James Young,
yeah,
who was this outrageous,
yeah,
drag performer, but drag in the sense that he had all kinds of characters that were Protestant and Catholic and Orange Lil. And I mean, yeah, really amazing commentary at that time culturally, you know. And then, as you say, then you have us as little kids where you're a hostage to your hormones anyway.
Yeah.
And then, not only that, I think it's even nearly impossible to be heterosexual, never mind any other kind.
Yeah, yeah.
Of the religious aspect of it and the foothold that the Catholic Church in our case had, you know. So certainly, and then what we had, which was the biggest brother of all, which was the Troubles, the war, the hunger strike, mm, internment, all those things that happened in front of us. Mm-hmm. And as you say, it was a daily struggle just to get to school without being beaten up or spat on or shot or caught up in a riot or any of those things. That was a daily occurrence for you and I, you know, growing, yeah, up. So, yeah, I think that sexuality took a back seat, because really there was no room on that bus, you know.
Yeah.
It was just oversubscribed until a little later on, when things calmed down a little bit. And as I say, your hormones really do kick in then. And then you just can't, depending on what your taste is, of course, the minute you see, you know, a flat, hairy tummy in the sports field, then suddenly you can't get it out of your mind for the rest.
That would do it, yeah.
That would do it, right? And depending on your taste, you know, some people like twinks and bears and otters and these things that we have now. But back in the day, raw masculinity, for whatever reason, had its own perfume, you know.
Yeah, it really did. Yeah, I mean, I remember actually going on to the gay scene, if you like. I was well underage, but it was the only, yeah, place to be.
Where did you go?
At the Parliament Bar.
Yeah, see, Parliament Bar didn't exist, but I know about it now.
Oh, I loved it.
Yeah, I went to a place called Carpenter's, which was right beside St. Anne's Cathedral. And St. Anne's Cathedral was somewhere I would have sung briefly as a young boy.
Yeah, that's right.
Songs of praise, you know. Yeah. Cut to a scene 3 or 4 years later, and kind of, you know, taking my life in my hands, leaving the Falls Road, getting through town late at night where the Mods and the Skinheads were prowling,
yeah,
and all that, and the British Army, of course, and all of those things. And then finally hanging out until finally some lovely young woman, you know, who was a clubber, took pity on me. She went, "Do you want to come in with us?" And
yeah,
that's my foray into the, yeah, what we call now the gay scene. But my, yeah, God, intoxicating. I mean, I could hardly breathe. It was so like, there's gay people in here? Oh,
yeah.
My God.
Yeah, yeah.
And they were right in front of her eyes.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. I mean, I was a cute sort of 17, 18 kind of thing, you know,
yeah,
maybe a bit younger, actually. And I remember a guy kissing me on the cheek. I'd been in the bar maybe 10 minutes, and he kissed me on the cheek, openly kissed me on the cheek. And I remember, yeah, the thrill and the fear and,
yeah,
the just, how the hell am I supposed to deal with it? What do you do when a guy kisses you on the cheek in, exactly, public?
And the thing is, you know, as you said earlier, the overriding sadness of that is that that's the first time somebody has been affectionate to you,
yeah,
in your own context, and you don't know what to do with it. And I was exactly, yeah, the same. And I think that that's why when we have, certainly we have things like, somebody was a whole discussion the other day about Grindr,
yeah,
online, and somebody talking about how handy it was and how exciting it was and sexy and all those things, but ultimately how damaging it is, because it's like, you know, first of all, it's sat-nav for a shag, as we know.
Yeah.
At the same time, it's also fast-forwarding. You don't get to date properly, really. You don't get to have emotions. You don't get to go into work the next day and go, I mean, you can do that now, probably. But back when we were 16, 15, who did you turn to if somebody, yeah, broke your heart? Who did you, yeah, turn to if you fancied somebody, or you were ghosted by somebody, or, you know, something like that happened? So, yeah, and my friend, I have a great friend called Rory Cowan. My neighbor up the street, he was in Mrs. Brown's Boys, you know.
Oh, yes, he was the son.
He lives, Yeah, exactly. He's an amazing fella. And again, a man in his early 60s. And we were talking about the fact that, you know, in those days, we never learned how to go courting. We never learned all those things that just regular, I call it ordinary, straight people just got to do whenever they wanted. We never got to do it. It was always in the darkness, under cover of dark,
yeah,
in the park, in god-awful toilets or Hampstead Heath or whatever it was. And so if you visit your intimacy in an atmosphere that's, first of all, dangerous, it's dark, it might be disgusting because it's some old toilet somewhere. Yeah. So then, of course, you associate those feelings with something that's kind of disgusting and that you shouldn't be doing it. So carry that forward to the future. And of course, no wonder, guess what, that the dictionary you have for being a gay person is littered with all of this negativity. And it's a very hard thing to shake off. But that's why you and me are here, because there might be somebody listening now to this podcast.
Yeah, exactly that. And that, do you know, I really genuinely, and I'm trying to not be cheesy about it, but I really genuinely hope that there is somebody listening to this conversation that goes, someday that's all just going to be a memory, all those thoughts. But you know, you were very involved with the church, as was I used to do the readings at mass, right? So,
well, it's so seductive, isn't it? I mean, it's first of all, it's beautifully lit. What gay person isn't going to go after good lighting, first of all? And of course, then the costumes and the outfits and the drama of it, you know, midnight mass and Easter and all of that. I mean, I was always a bit of a magpie anyway. Anything glittery, I'm there, you know.
Yeah,
but at the same time, you know, the unspoken idea that it's somewhere that you can kind of hide.
Yeah.
You know, I remember that certainly it was propositioned to me that it would be probably a good idea if I became a priest. That was the message coming from the family. They really knew something different about me.
Isn't that what they all used to do? Oh, yeah. He's not one for marrying, he's a priest.
he's perfect for a priest, that one, you know, all of that stuff. He has a sensitivity, he has a, And back in the day, we had a next door neighbor, actually, who was a priest eventually, and he was treated like a star, like a celebrity.
Yeah.
The minute he arrived in the street, oh my God, it was like a celebrity had arrived.
It's so true. It's so true. It's so true. Now, I've got to say, I was one of the lucky ones, and I very was lucky in that, you know, I imagined my family were going to hate me. I imagined, you know, that I was going to feel the wrath of God and all this.
Yes.
And actually, when it all came about, it was actually the complete opposite. And I remember being in a pub with my dad. And my dad's a man's man, you know.
Yeah.
And he said to me, I'm proud of you, son. No, I'm not proud of you just because you're gay. I'm proud of you because you've got the balls to be for where you've come from, you know.
And I think that's a really good way to see it, because
you
know, a lot of things that are leveled at us as young gay people or whatever you identify now is there was always a cowardice associated with being gay. What's at the back of that, you know, I think, is that it's really misogyny. If you exhibit any kind of quality that might be deemed female, then that's something to be ashamed of, and therefore less than. And really, that's misogyny. That's hatred of femininity.
Yeah.
Certainly one of the worst things we could have been called as kids was a girl.
Yeah. Well, actually, you know, isn't that the reason, you know, the whole biblical stuff? It's because a bloke is behaving like a woman in the sexual intercourse, so therefore it's a shame.
Yeah. Depending, of course, you've just revealed whether you're a top or a bottom there, Anthony. Well done.
Well, I said the woman.
All right.
I'm really good home, Brian.
Well, you know, whatever. But as you say, it's interesting. And even to this day, you know, and pull me back if I go off on too much of a tangent.
No, you're grand. I love it.
But I believe that one of the things that happens in jail, happens in mafia world, is that they, if they really, really, really want to take over an area, they'll find the boss of that area. Yeah. They'll kidnap him. They'll film him being topped by somebody. And then they'll say, if you don't want that footage to be released of you being topped by another man, then you better do what we tell you. And so it's used even then as an incredibly violent tool.
Yeah.
In other words, in their world, the worst thing you could be doing is being topped by somebody. Very interesting what happens with masculinity in that world.
Yeah. Actually, was it the Vikings or some of the historical ones used to rape after they'd conquered?
That's
really
correct.
Interesting. Yeah, really interesting. But how did you, so you're transitioning, so, you know, I mean, I grew up definitely with rich religion and tight cultures and small communities, but my God, yours was microscopic. It was really tight.
It really was.
How did that transition thing happen? Was it smooth? Was it an absolute nightmare? Something in between?
It was, I mean, it was mostly a nightmare because there was no well-beaten path. There was no, oh, that's Paddy and Johnny up the road and, you know, they're bachelors. Or, you know, we only ever learned about same-sex union in an abusive context.
Yeah.
The context was some creepy old guy, you know, pulling children into the park, or literally from the pulpit. I remember acutely priests standing up there, probably hungover, probably in a complete homosexual panic themselves, you know, talking about how homosexuals would burn in hell.
Yeah.
They would say this on like a Sunday morning at 9:30 in a packed church, you know, with all the men at the back all trying to get out in time for the sport, you know, kind of thing. And the air full of cigarette smoke, full of all of those kind of things. And then given where I was on the Falls Road, Sunday, you know, rioting did not take Sunday off, you know, if there was trouble. So, yeah, I mean, it was a very, 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 very dangerous atmosphere that unfortunately you got used to. So I saw things as a child that probably most adults will never see. So I had lots of adult concerns as a young boy. And one of the only gifts of that, I think, is that it's made me a very robust human being. So whether I've had to face into great illness or great loss, there seems to be a robustness that I can count on in those situations. And I would really credit that to the Falls Road, the early days, having to encounter, you know, the British soldier saying something disgusting to me about my mother or my sister
at
school. I mean, we'd be on the way to school and they'd be saying things like that. And all of those kind of things. Or being out with my grandfather briefly, and they would make him take off his shoes and his socks in the rain, and some little squaddy from Lancashire or somewhere who's like 19 and shitting himself.
Yeah.
And then his idea of sport is to make a granddad in front of his grandson take most of his clothes off to search him for in the buckling rain. I mean, it's degradation on a daily level. And what does that do to your confidence? Yeah. And also, you know, about the turnstiles at the bottom of the Falls Road that didn't exist anywhere else. So it was very definitely a ghettoization and therefore a ghettoization of the mind in the same sense. But I mean, again, music to the rescue.
Yeah.
When I hear Kate Bush sing The Man with the Child in His Eyes, or Michael Jackson sing Ben, or ABBA sing Dancing Queen, I mean, the clues are all there. You know, when these records started to even get through that atmosphere in West Belfast, well, my God, it was just like, what is that? And to this day, I mean, it was like the future was waving at me. I got to be a little bit friendly with Kate Bush, and she invited me to her house for dinner when I sent her my record and all these
things. Shut up.
I know, that's a whole other program. I mean, things like that you just think, that's so amazing, that if my little terrified self could have known that as a grown-up, I would make my own records and master them where the Beatles made their records in EMI in Abbey Road. And then Kate Bush would hear it and invite me for dinner and talk to me about my record. That obviously happened, you know, a decade or so later. But I mean, it is amazing what happens in your life to flip your whole experience. Same with Boy George, you know, in terms of, I remember being 17 and seeing him on the tube live from Japan New Year's Eve. And he comes out in a wedding dress. Remember all that?
Yeah.
And then years, I mean, like 30 years later or something, I got to know him a little bit, and we duet on my song Christopher Street on my collection and all that. And I mean, and I sing on his album, Things Are Going to Change Around Here, that song. I mean, just amazing, mad things like that, where you think, if only I could have told my young self that those things were ahead, things truly do get better. But of course, how do you believe that at the time? You just put one foot in front of the other.
Yeah.
Try and not fall into a riot or a bonfire, and then slowly but surely you realize you cannot stay there. I mean, the earliest message I got was, you better get out of here. London, anything like that, the priesthood, anything like that, just get out. It's not safe.
Yeah. And I think actually, you know, when I think about so my parents separated sort of when I was about 7. So prior to that, we lived in Glengormley in a nice detached house. And we went from there to, you know, Antrim, and we were in terraced houses in crazy times and rough estates. And I remember actually that sort of message in my brain from about 7 years of age: honey, we're not in Kansas anymore. get out of here.
Well, we were never in Kansas, as you know. I mean, my God, so funny you say that, because every Christmas, my absolute favorite thing to do was watch
Wizard of Oz.
Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
I mean, to this day, it's still my favorite film.
Yeah.
I get chills. I saw a clip of it the other day. Somebody was showing something and I just got chills. I'm like, oh, I mean, that scene where they go from, you know, from black and white into color. It was so interesting when I saw the movie Belfast, you know.
Yes.
And they go from color and, you know, they go the other way. So it's absolutely amazing. You know, so they start off in black and white and color in The Wizard of Oz, but, you know, suddenly they go into black and white.
Mm-hmm.
They do the opposite at the beginning of that movie. And I'm actually singing in that movie and I didn't even know it. I'm singing on a song called Days Like This with Van Morrison.
Yeah.
And I, you know, they don't have to have my permission to do that. But it was so fascinating to be even a part of a kind of a fantasy version of Kenneth Branagh's very middle class lens, I thought, on.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw the movie or not, but
how I've seen Rushes. I've not watched it all in one go.
It's
but
really
I've seen
worth
Rushes,
watching.
But it looks good, yeah.
It's really worth watching. You know, it's another lens on what happened. It's not my lens. In fact, when he left Northern Ireland, that's when my childhood began.
Yeah.
And also, he's not coming from West Belfast. He comes from North Belfast. And like I say, but I really loved that he went from color into black and white very quickly at the start. And, you know, the soundtrack's not too shabby, the rest of it as well. But interesting that he calls it a love letter to Belfast. And that's, I think that's a lovely intention. But it's hard to write a love letter to a nightmare, you know.
I think. An abusive ex in many ways, but also
very much so.
But was and will always be home, I suppose. So I've got to ask you, so wee man from West Belfast.
Yeah.
Dealing with all the gay stuff, I'm guessing not a very rich family. How the hell did you become an international superstar, pop star? What the hell? How did that happen?
Well, I don't think of myself like that at all. But yeah, I mean, we came from very disadvantaged circumstances. Let's call it that. You know, certainly I was aware of the things where, I mean, as you know, you don't really understand how disadvantaged you are until you meet somebody who isn't. And then you start sharing stories about childhood and all, and literally you're going, no, we didn't get pocket money. No, you know, no, we didn't have a lovely granny who made us cakes every Sunday, you know, all of that.
Did you ever watch Neighbours, right? I used to see them coming in on Neighbours and we're like, hi, mum, love you. And I was like,
yeah, I know.
Imagine speaking to your family like that.
I occasionally know. I have a lovely brother called Stuart that I'm very, I'm close to, you know, and so we'll be out in these situations. But people think because now I'm a singer now and a recording artist now and all of that, they think I've always just been that guy, right?
Yeah.
And so I do occasionally get people just making all kinds of wild assumptions about my childhood. And it's, and you know, so we'll chat to people and hear stories about, you know, when they'll say, you know, when you used to play like a chess tournament with your dad, and certainly they'll just go, what? What are you talking about? You know, and it just is what it is. You know, it was a very, very particular time in history. It was a very violent upbringing inside the house as well as outside the house, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so therefore I put in place a coping mechanism called estrangement. I mean, that's what happened. After years of therapy, I realized that estrangement was really the safest bet for me.
Right.
And that's still the case. I'm close to Stuart and no one else. And our dad passed away last year and all of that. And so, you know, and then my eldest brother passed away also, but I managed to reach out to him just before that happened. We both had cancer at the same time. You might know that or might not.
Yes, I did. And I think I saw something. Was there something about that in the press, I believe,
but,
as well?
I mean, I think, can you tell as a typical Libran, I'm really crap with accepting your compliments and I'm trying to, you know, take the ring road around what we're saying. Look, as you know, certainly famous people, well-known people, musical people were few and far between when we grew up. But certainly there was a band called the Star Jets who were local, who were the first people to sort of kind of break through. And then my eldest brother's band did a little stint on the Tube on England, you know, on UK TV. And so suddenly there were these, and then the punk movement had happened. I just missed it. I was just too young for it. But certainly what it indicated was, hang on a minute, it is possible to do something that you're not supposed to be doing and be successful. You know, there was all these little threads of things all coming together to weave an idea in my brain that maybe singing was something I might do that made me feel good about myself, first of all. And also other people would kind of slightly take note if I did it. So slowly but surely, I started singing in church, started all of that, joined my brother's band, moved to London, because by then, really, it was like literally you can't stay in Northern Ireland. You have to go to London or America to try and make something happen. So when I think of it now, you know, I was so brave, really, because it was such a well-trodden path, that idea that, you know, that a young Irish person could go to Northern Ireland. Potentially, we're talking about 1985. So really, I was still a terrorist in the eyes of airport police. You know, they would pull me over. They would, you know, detain me for hours because my previous address was the Falls Road. Yeah. And they'd say, but what are you doing here? Oh, well, I'm trying to, you know, make a life for myself. But where, you know, all of that interrogation right up until I got my first CD. I remember I was able to pull it out of my bag and go, that's what I do. Right. I'm not here to be a terrorist. I'm here to do this. And I was asked, and I hope you don't mind me wandering off the subject again.
Not at all.
But it's appropriate. I was asked by the lovely Gloria Hunniford to come and sing at an award ceremony that she was getting not that long ago, about 5-6 years ago, in the Irish Embassy in London. You may know that building. And we were talking about how few Northern Irish accents that there were in England at that time mm-hmm. to represent us beyond, you know, terrorism. So have you ever seen that movie, that TV show called Outnumbered?
No, I've not, no.
So it's basically a middle-class couple with three really precocious kids. And it's set in London. And so they're talking about, the mum's talking to the wee daughter, and they're talking about Muslims. And she's saying, well, you know, obviously people think Muslims are terrible. It's awful. You know, you know how they used to think about the Irish here.
Mm-hmm.
And the wee girl looks at her and she goes, what? And she goes, well, you know, back in the day, people thought that the Irish, in particular Northern Irish people, were terrorists. And the wee girl just suddenly goes, what, do you mean like Graham Norton and Jedward? Like, it was such a wonderful cultural shift of, that's where her wee brain was, like, huh? What are you talking about? And so first of all, there's hope for us all, including the Muslim community, to reconfigure how people think of us. And second of all, that's where we were.
Yeah.
I mean, we literally were terrorists.
Yeah,
I remember people. I remember people spitting at me in the tube when I was singing and talking, and but I was a busker at the time. You know, a lot of, and then also a lot of lovely help and gorgeous people and people who embraced me. And my life would never have been the same had I not gone to London and suddenly singing and being taken seriously. I met Simon Fuller because of a group called The Adventures. I signed a massive record deal, and that's what started me on this trajectory. And now I'm in the middle of recording album number 18, would you believe?
Wow. Do you know, I can believe it, actually, because you kind of been omnipresent through my sort of, you know, you've always been a name that I've known, and your music, I've always known it. So yeah, I can believe it. And actually, that's one of the things that I've got to say, you know, because stars go up, stars come down, and I know, you know, Top of the Pops and all the different, but your name has never, it's never lost its value. It's never.
Hasn't it? I'm not aware of it.
No, but it's never become cringe.
That's good.
Never.
I suppose it depends on who you talk to. Look, I think one of the things that's really apparent to me as I get older, and especially when you have brushes with death and so on, like I did a couple of times with cancer and then with quadruple heart bypass, it was only 2 years ago. You know, I think that want to be as calmly authentic as possible. I'm not going after authenticity as a job description. I'm going after as, you know, something that is calmly part of who I am. And I think that in order to do that, it's important to come out as queer or gay or trans or whatever it is you are. Come out as that person, because then you're really speaking from the purest part of yourself. And I understand that there are people out there who've completely reinvented themselves as far as even going and changing their entire names and so on. And that's all fine. I'm not necessarily worried about that, because certainly one of the things that I realize is I've completely reinvented myself.
Yeah.
I'm not that wee boy in the Falls Road who talks like that there.
Oh, you
know,
I
get
what you mean. Like,
oh, you know what I mean?
Oh, I do.
Okay.
You're mad.
You fuck up. All of that.
Stay up your own door.
Exactly. Wait, Noel.
See?
You know, and I love all of that. And that's why I loved James Young for that reason, because he would step into all of those, you know, into that vernacular and all of those kind of characters. But certainly one of the greatest joys of being a recording artist is that you get to record your life. You record how you are at that moment in time. When I hear recordings of myself 20 years ago or 30 years ago, I hear who I was and I hear flaws. I hear things that I wish I had now. I hear optimism. I hear confidence. I hear, you know, all kinds of things that I'm still working on and that still make me hopefully as authentic as I can without going after that as a label, just as a feeling and a truth, you know.
And you know, you mentioned there, you've kind of faced doubt, you know, death in the eyes a couple of times.
I have, unfortunately.
You know,
I have, yes.
you have. And estrangement, and then this massive career. And I mean, your balancing or your skills to deal with that, I suppose, maybe are much more acute than many others. But I would imagine that there might also be a bit more need for a bit of love or TLC or...
Yeah.
How do you get it? Where do you get it? Where do you find it? How do you hold on to it?
It's a good one, you know, because again, it harks back to childhood, to having to... I mean, I'm the kind of person that very calmly, if I'm confronted with a situation, I will think of the worst thing that could possibly happen first.
Right.
Because I'll then go, okay, if that happened, how would I deal with that? Mm. Now, I'm doing that very calmly as I'm looking at you and I'm talking to you. And that comes from growing up in the middle of a war, in the middle of a riot, in the middle of a bomb, where you have to very quickly go, oh, Jesus, what will I do? Get under that car. Then they won't shoot me. Yeah. All those things, right?
Yeah.
So then I've developed that thing in later life. I've been single for a very long time. You know, certainly, I've had lots of fun along the way, and I've met some incredible people. But certainly, I think that there's, if I'm truthful, which I am in this moment, I think that it's really taken a toll on that side of my life.
Right.
In terms of growing up and having to really hide who you are. In the 80s, the first pandemic I ever met was HIV and AIDS.
Yeah, sure.
So it was another reason to not be yourself. And then we had to unpack, as you would say, unravel all of that and say, no. Just because I like someone of my own sex doesn't mean to say I'm going to die of AIDS next year.
I can't
like everybody. And then the next thing is paedophilia and on you know, unwrapping that from people's minds.
Yep.
But as we know, you know, paedophiles are very often, it's a same sex thing, that's as in it's an opposite sex thing.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's an opposite sex thing. But and then weirdly in our language now, in gay language, that I can see online and out and about when I travel the world, this is bizarre language that's crept back in to do with this whole daddy culture. Now, the first time I ever heard of that was Marilyn Monroe singing My Heart Belongs to Daddy and all these things and blah, blah, blah. So it's creepy on any level. And it's not just in a gay world. It's been in the straight world for a long time. It's as creepy there as it is here. It's interesting that there's lots of kind of weird, I would call it weird language, that's creeping into... You know, when somebody really wants you to call them daddy in bed.
I couldn't. Oh, I could not.
Couldn't, wouldn't, never will, not happening, never will happen. You know, I couldn't even call my own dad daddy, never mind anybody else.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's interesting what's happening with the language. And of course, there might be somebody kind of going, oh, for goodness sake, calm down. It's only this. And I've been challenged a few times by my friends, and I'll say, okay, tell me what it is. Mm. So what does it actually mean? Why can't you call your lover by their name, by their... Mm. When you're having a passionate exchange, it's a very specific thing. So I think that we've gone obviously millions of steps forward and a good few steps back. I mean, I'm not sure when this is going out, but already I've, you know, reacted to a horrible homophobic attack on a young teenager in Meath.
Right.
It happened yesterday, I believe. So we're certainly not out of any kind of woods in terms of, you know, look what's happening with the trans community, all of those kinds of things. So I suppose, again, if I will actually get back to your question, you know, it's been a very difficult time when you estrange yourself from this city, from a family. You don't ever grow up in a regular situation. So my experience of family made me never want to have a family or be in a family.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of quietly in awe of families that work.
Yeah.
And regardless of what version of family that is, there's all kinds of versions of family, of course. So, yeah, I think one of the legacies of my experience thus far, I'm 56 and a half, I'll be 57 in October. You know, never say never. I may well end up with a gorgeous companion, gorgeous fella who has his own world going on and his own stuff going on. And that's great. We come together as companions and we have a lot. I would never rule that out. But I would say to you, Mr. 45, that the longer you stay, you know, the longer that you create your own universe, everything I have, I made it myself.
Yeah.
Thing, you know, in this house I'm sitting in, the career I have, the car I drive, blah, blah, blah. You know, I've created mostly all of that myself. And on one hand, I do want to say to you that if the right person came along, I would make room for them in 2 seconds, and hopefully they would make room for me.
Yeah.
But in the last bunch of times that I've kind of come close to relationship, I found that I had to unscrew too many light bulbs to not be so bright around them. And yeah. That's a compromise too far, I think.
I totally agree.
You know, and so that's all I would say about that. And my light bulbs are firmly screwed in, and they're as bright as they will be. And I want somebody to really celebrate that about me, not denigrate it.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, so my sort of main, I've worked in media in many different, when I was sort of 15, 16, I was a model and I was a dancer. And then,
right.
But my main sort of thing was, I was part of the first of a partnership team. So we effectively.
Were you?
Yeah. So that all came through our office kind of
thing. Are you civilly partnered now? Are you attached now?
No, God, no. I never did. No, God, no.
No.
But I remember thinking, and I actually remember saying to who was my business partner, I remember saying, do you remember one of the first things you accepted when you really did go, right, okay, I am a gay, this is for me, and this I can't deny it anymore.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be able to get married, and I'm not going to be able to have children.
That's right.
So you put that in the bin and you deal with that, and you know, and then something you said earlier, and I thought, there it is, there's my commitment phobia there. Because everything that was to do with affection was shame. It was under the cover of darkness. It was done in shame. So, you know, I went out with wee girls, you know, I had weak relationships with wee girls, and they were great and all the rest, but you were never fully in them. So if I'm truly honest with myself, have I ever been in a relationship where it felt like what I guess a relationship's supposed to feel like?
Yeah.
Never, ever. Yeah. But, you know, I've re-qualified now. I've just qualified as a barrister and going into that profession. And I'm getting a wee bit older and a wee bit more like into being at home with a bottle of wine rather than in a club getting shoved about. And I do think sometimes, you know what, it would be nice to have somebody here. But I don't think it would be fair to somebody to bring them into me kind of almost. I don't think I have that. Like you said, I'm not switching any bulbs off. I'm not compromising what I want to watch on TV.
I mean, we work too hard to have,
you know,
them.
Yeah. You know,
we work too hard to be a barrister, to create a completely new life for yourself.
Yeah.
Why on earth would you then go, oh, okay, there's somebody that's kind of attractive. I better not be myself.
Yeah.
Authenticity has been hard fought for and hard won.
Yeah.
Why on earth would you? I mean, I see all kinds of relationships, and especially with, look, on one hand, I'm trying not to be judgy, but I do love Judge Judy. I really do.
Yeah.
And I see that there are people out there who say, oh, no, we have an open relationship. It's fine. It works fine. Blah, blah, blah. Mm. Are you kidding me?
I mean,
I'm a bad gay. I'm an old-fashioned gay.
Yeah.
I've got Kylie records.
Yeah.
I really don't have an opinion about Madonna, particularly apart from thanks for standing by all the people with HIV in the 80s. Well done.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, you know, I'm a Joni Mitchell fan. I'm a Kate Bush fan. I like that kind of musicianship and singing.
Yeah.
And I'm trying not to sound like a snobby wanker either.
No, I love it. You know? I love it.
At the same time, honestly, I'm an old-fashioned gay. I want one guy.
Yeah.
Just wants me.
Mm.
And if there's a problem somewhere in it and he really wants to stray off and do something, I'll go, okay, do you want to talk about it?
Mm.
Or do you want to leave? Which one is it?
Yeah.
See ya, or meet me for dinner. I wonder what the problem is. What's going on? You know, tell me about it. You know, and if it's, you know, I want to wear a harness and I want to do this, that, and the other, and I want to, well, you know, knock yourself out. But the thing is, I'm 56 now.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not 25 and 26 and I'm experimenting and I'm trying to work out who I am.
Yeah.
I know what I want. I'm old fashioned. I love love.
Yeah.
I love, you know, I would like to get the end of my life and go, I was able to commit myself to that person truthfully.
Yeah.
That would be an amazing achievement, I think, rather than I rode everybody around me. And I'm not just talking about gay people. Straight people do it all the time, you know. So I think the idea of faithfulness might make a big return. And
yeah.
As much as it's tempting to be able to have this notion of openness. And look, honestly, if you're truthfully happy that your husband is saying to you, oh, I just got a great meal on Grindr there, I'm going to wean him on Thursday.
Yeah.
I'll see you at 9 for dinner after. And, you know, again, if you truly are okay with that, knock yourself out. It just wouldn't work for me.
No, and that's it. And I mean, obviously, I have friends who are in all variations of the spectrum.
Yeah, me too.
Because you just do, right? And I've had the many a debate because there is, you know, there's that little Catholic boy as well, you know, one man, you know, you've got your... But when I think about it, you know, when I think about relationships, I used to think of it, gosh, I'm too selfish for a relationship. Mm-hmm. But actually it isn't. It's actually the opposite. It's I'm too very much aware that I probably would have the potential to destroy somebody in a relationship because there isn't room. You know, I'm busy, and I don't have a lot of compromise. And my friends and my family are my treasures. They're my assets.
Yeah.
And they're not for sale. So all of those things considered, somebody coming into that, they would have to be a robot, I would imagine, to not be, you know, affected by it. But the reason that I asked it was the life that, you know, I've worked in media, so I know how insecure it is, and I know the insecurities it gives you. I've come from troubled zones. I know how insecure it is and the insecurities it gives you. Mm-hmm. And then you've had massive trauma. And I just wonder, where do you get, you know, where is your source of love? Is it friends? Is it just the music and that's your entire world? Or where does it come from?
I mean, it can't just be music because you know, that's just not enough, you know.
Right.
Friendships are, I have, it's interesting actually, because it's mostly women in my life.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I've got very, very, like, women friends who've been my friends for over 30 years. I'm seeing them this week. We're going away together. I've just been a Nice with one of my best friends, two of them, in fact, but one from like 30 odd years ago. And we just had a lovely time. And some of them are single, some of them are not single. And most of us don't have any children. There's very few that anybody's got kids. And if they did have kids, those kids are grown now. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to be a product of our generation, coming from, whether you're a young straight woman or a gay man, in my case.
Yeah.
I mean, it's certainly what I love is that I love the life that I have.
Right.
See, the thing about what you were just touching on earlier was that, and it's homophobic, I think, in its intent, not your homophobia.
Yeah.
People saying that it's kind of selfish, you know, how selfish to want to actually cherish and celebrate yourself, nice life and a nice house and nice friends, and not have to somehow. I mean, I remember somebody said to me recently, well, I mean, what about settling down? And I said to him, listen, I take absolute exception with that term. I'm very settled in my life. I have a wonderfully settled life. I'm not sitting around going, oh God, what will I do? I'm 18 albums into my own solo career. I've published 2 novels. I'm working on other things. Like, I'm busy, busy creatively. I love to travel the world. My diary has woken up again after 2 years of being quiet. I've survived cancer. I've survived a major heart attack.
Yeah.
And I still have a sense of humor. And occasionally I have a bit of fun with, you know, old friends.
Yeah.
In terms of the sex part of things.
Yeah.
But that's less and less, you know. I love going for dinner. I love discovering a new restaurant. I love a decent glass of something, but even that's beginning to kind of leave my life too, you know.
Yeah.
I'm a margarita though, hard to turn one of those down. And then just keep trying to be better at what I do and keep traveling the world. And I love interior design. I mean, I couldn't be gayer, you know. I mean, I've got an Edwardian 3-story house that I love to keep in good shape. And
right.
I'm forever moving the paintings around and the books around and all of that stuff, and chandeliers. I do actually have chandeliers in my life.
So do I. Well, you can't see, but yeah.
Well, I'll show you mine, will I? There you go.
Can you see mine?
I do.
Nearly.
There you go.
Did you get it?
Is it black?
No, it's like a crystal color. It's because the camera's to blur the background.
Yeah.
And I just had some black paint arrive as well.
Oh, today very good. And, you know, look, I get to go to Belfast and go and not walk around in fear, walk around in great confidence. And the lovely thing about the little bit of fame that I have is that it's mostly incredibly positive, where somebody will come up to me with their little kids and go, oh, can we do a photograph with my little nephew, my little niece? And I'm thinking, you're also doing a photograph with an openly gay man.
Yeah.
And that's a lovely, lovely, lovely thing, you know.
Yeah. And I think actually, because I remember it in the press, you come out as bi, I think, initially, didn't you?
And that's right.
Yeah.
I'm very comfortably bi. I played with it actually later on in life when I looked straight down the lens of the camera and said, people don't know this about me, but I'm actually bi. And then lingual, because I could speak a bit of Irish and English. But yes, I was very comfortable at that point with the notion of bisexuality, because I was still experimenting more with men than with women, but I certainly had sex with women on and off. And the last time I did anything with a woman, I was 30, actually.
Right.
And it really was the clincher. It really was the kind of, look, how long can you experiment for? How long can you? Because I think that bisexuality, as my friend says, you know, bi now, gay later, you know. And I kind of think that's a play. That's very playful and very truthful, I think. I think bisexuality for me, and I genuinely know bisexual people who are genuinely bisexual, yeah. Both men and women. That's real. That's not real. But for me, it was a holding pattern.
Right.
To see how that looked, to see how it felt, to see how my bisexuality sat with other people.
Yeah.
And it was a very gradual thing. And then slowly but surely, I realized, well, bisexuality is really not honest. It's not authentic for me. And so then it was important to say, actually, do you know what? I absolutely have made up my mind. I'm exclusively romantically and sexually interested in men of my own, you know, people of my own sex. So but it took a long time to cook. And I think anybody should be allowed to take their own time, unless you are somebody who's creating laws that really defame and hurt people like us, and you're secretly gay yourself. There was a great discussion, obviously, about how long it took, say, somebody like Philip Schofield to come out or people like that. And I think I have two sets of feelings about that. On one hand, I think the poor fella, what a torture for his wife and children who didn't even know, maybe, or maybe they did know. And then on another part of me thinks, God, I'm very glad that he clearly came to a point one day and thought, oh, Jesus Christ, I better. Time is moving on. I mean, how old is that man? He's in his 60s, I presume. You know, my heart went out to him and all that whole situation. But that's because he's a man of a certain generation. You know, I mean, certainly, thankfully, one of the great things about right now, it's kind of nearly boring just to be gay. You know, I'm nearly sort of just go, sorry, I'm just kind of gay. Sorry about that. You know, and these days, you know, people, especially young people, they don't give a flying fuck. They're like the young people of Northern Ireland, who I call the untroubled generation. They're not of the troubles.
That's right.
And now there's a young generation of gay, trans, whatever. And I know the trans people are not having an easy time at all. And as we see, even from the press today, people are still beating up young gay people. So it's not over. The fight isn't over. Pride is still very important. The marches are important. And visibility is incredibly important. So people like you and me living happy, productive lives and going, oh, yeah, P.S., I also fancy men.
Yeah.
You know, it's really, really important. I didn't really get that for years, and I had my own internal homophobia to deal with as well.
Yeah.
But I did a lot of therapy, and I reckon I've worked most of it out. So
yeah, I definitely had quite a bit of that myself as well, actually. Not possible. But I remember actually going, and it wasn't the first gay pride in Belfast, but I think it was only a few in. I think it would have been 96 or 97 or something. I did it. And I remember there was a couple of hundred at best. And we went through the city centre, and faggot, turd burglars, paedophile, all that sort of stuff was, you know, shouted at us. And then fast forward X amount of years, I'm on the stage at Pride introducing my friend Kezzy Silverstone to 50,000 people, right?
Yeah, I mean, it is unimaginable. It is unimaginable. And it's, thank God, it's manageable. And I remember when the marriage referendum was going on here, and first of all, obviously in Dublin, I was very much part of that. And I wrote a song called Please Say Yes. And I delayed my tour to Australia so that I could vote here for it. And I then got on the plane and flew all the way to Brisbane, got into my hotel room in Brisbane, wrecked, turned on the TV, and there's Panty and Leo Varadkar and people like that, live from Dublin Castle, and it's a yes.
Yes.
It's just so extraordinary to think that we were illegal in something like 92, 93. And, you know, and then there we are, fast forward to the future, where we now live in a country where, you know, our Taoiseach is mixed race and openly gay, abortion is legal, and, you know, and we have gay marriage. I mean, that's the kind of country I want to live in.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Brian, I think I'm a little bit in love with you and could chat with you all night until my commitment phobia kicked in, and then
Well, I mean, let's have a drink at some point if you're ever in Dublin, or I'm ever in Stoke or wherever.
We will make it happen.
Or indeed Belfast.
Yeah, well, we have the mutual Michelle Maturin.
We do, aren't we lucky?
We're very lucky. Yeah. She's known as the wife. Actually, her and I are off on holiday next month. We're off to Bulgaria.
Oh, very good.
Yeah,
I have actually a few wives.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I have a couple of wives.
You're very naughty. But before you go, other than what's happening in Lorne, you've a new album coming out. What's going on?
Well, the album that I'm making right now is the second volume of tribute to Joni Mitchell. Joni Mitchell turns 80 in November. I toured with Joni Mitchell across America with Van Morrison.
Bloody love Joni, by the way.
Oh, my God. In 1998, I got to tour with her across America. So I then made the album, A Love Letter to Joni, that you can find online. So this is volume two of that. And I'm in the middle of recording that. I'm also making some music with Moya Brennan from Clonard. We just had a little meeting about that. I'm working on other writing, as in not songwriting, actual story writing. Yeah. And then gigging, touring, recording, all kinds of things are going on. So my diary is literally those pings that you were hearing during the interview, that's requests coming through.
Gorgeous.
Things. My diary is beginning to actually wake up again because, fantastic, number one, I haven't died.
Yeah. And they could book you without worrying, right?
Yeah, and I got through COVID. I survived COVID, and I'm still around. And also, then venues and tours, and everything's waking up again. So it's a great excitement. So I'm going to see Michelle tomorrow. I'll give her your love, will I? Are you? I'm sure you do it yourself.
Yes.
And then I'm going to sing, do that, and look, on it goes. As long as I can be as close to music as possible, I'll be very happy, man.
Well, long may you reign, sir. Social media. How do we follow you?
So at Brian Singing Kennedy, or at Kennedy Singer, go to the website. It's all connected there. The Facebook is linked up to it.
Gorgeous.
Just have a look at Twitter. Have a look at Dr. Brian Kennedy, because I've been given an honorary doctorate for my literature and music contributions over the years. So occasionally I rock out my doctor title.
I love it.
Whenever it feels good. People can get me that way. The easiest way to contact me for anything, it literally on the front of the website says inquiries@briankennedy.co.uk. That's the web address we bought years ago.
Yeah.
And of course I've got .ie, but somebody had nicked briankennedy.com, you see, back in the day. Somebody already got it.
Some flipping scumbag.
Yeah, so that I'm very easily contacted if you're wanting me to kind of come and do something, and you can afford me, of course. I feel very, very, very fortunate to be surrounded by so much creativity and interesting people, and to still be alive, to have survived the things I've gone through.
And it's so lovely to hear that from you, and it's obvious. You've mentioned authenticity quite a few times. And I've got to say, and I genuinely mean this, probably one of the most authentic chats I've had. And I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I really appreciate you. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. And listen, Anthony, you're very, very easy to talk to.
Until it's 9 o'clock in the morning.
How's that? Yeah. Your poor barrister brain.
Yeah, take care. Take care. Bye.
See you soon. Bye-bye.
Good luck, everybody. Bye-bye.
I can hear her heartbeat from a thousand miles. Yeah, the heavens open every time she smiles. When I come to her, that's where I belong. Yeah, I run to her like a river song. She gave me love, love, love. Love, 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 love,